I can report that over the last 24 hours we've had 22,069 new cases recorded. 3,985 of those are people who have registered a positive rapid antigen test. So thank you to all of those people in Queensland who are getting tested at home and registering their positive results. That assists us to understand the level of infection in the community and also to support them in their isolation period. That puts us at 130,947 active cases. We have four new local government areas that have infections. That is Baku, Bourke, Croydon, Napranum, which actually only leaves us with two local government areas in Queensland that haven't reported any positive cases since the 13th of December. We did 57,604 testing samples in the last 24 hours. So again, I thank all of our testing clinics and our pathologists for the great work that they're doing. We now have 30 people in ICU in Queensland with COVID. Eight of these people are ventilated, and 525 additional people who are COVID positive patients in wards. Vaccination, can I say, what we're seeing in our hospitalisation rates right now and in ICU reflects our vaccination rates. And I want to thank everyone who continues to come out and get vaccinated, because we know this has helped slow down the number of people coming into our hospital system and needing ICU. I want to keep encouraging people to come forward, get their first dose if they haven't had any vaccination, second dose as soon as it's due, and of course your booster. We know boosters are important, and we know that over 50% of the eligible population who are able to get their boosters haven't got their boosters yet. Our vaccination clinics are open for boosters, and also our pharmacies and GPs. So please come forward and get your booster as soon as you're due. And I remind all Queenslanders that if it has been 4 months since your second dose, then you can get your booster shot now. And that will change again on the 31st of January. But for now, if it's been 4 months, come forward and get vaccinated. That's put our vaccination rates at 91.23% of our eligible population, 16 plus, have had one dose, and 88.02% double dose. So we are getting closer to that 90% mark. We did 5,558 5 to 11 year olds yesterday. I'm thrilled, and we've got over 39,000 young people now booked in to get vaccinations at our state clinics. So again, thanks to all the mums and dads that are lining up there with the kids, and to all of the health workers and everyone involved in our vaccination program. Our boosters, we've now totaled 748,053 boosters have been administered across Queensland. So again, thanks to everyone for continuing to get vaccinated. I'll now hand over to the Chief Health Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. So as before, I'm going to focus on the situation in Queensland hospitals. There are 30 patients in intensive care unit, in the intensive care units of Queensland hospitals at present, eight of whom are ventilated. That's up from 27 yesterday, so still small numbers, and that's due to vaccination. There are 525 cases in hospital requiring treatment for COVID-19, so that's overall, and that's up from 502, so that's gradually creeping up at this stage. We now have enough data from around 500 patients to see some real trends in who's ending up in Queensland hospitals. And the importance of boosted vaccination is very clear. If you are unvaccinated, you are 9 times more likely to end up in hospital than if you have received boosted vaccination, that is 3 doses of vaccine. I'll say that again. If you are unvaccinated, you are 9 times more likely to end up in a Queensland hospital than if you are triple vaxxed. And I want to leave that at that point with that thought, and I'll hand back over to the Minister for it. Thank you.
Well, there's one organisation who's calling on that. Craig, although he's officially on leave, has been involved in every briefing. He has been involved in meetings and conversations with stakeholders on a daily basis and has been involved in the decision making. So I also want to say that our acting commissioner, who is in the role now, Dee, is doing an incredible job. She has relieved as acting commissioner a number of times, and there is no question that she's more than capable and competent of fulfilling that role currently. So those claims that I've seen that he is missing in action and not involved, not getting any briefings, is completely inaccurate.
What would prompt them to then make those claims?
You have to ask them that. Maybe it's a recruitment tool. Well, that's interesting, because one of those major unions have been on radio this morning praising Craig for the work he's been doing. So they've been in contact with him while he's been on leave. He's been engaging with stakeholders. He's been at briefings and he has been involved in decision making. So it's just not accurate to say that he has been missing in action. Yes. Yes. So when we say our ICU numbers and our hospitalisation numbers, they are two separate numbers, yeah. We're not mandating the third doses at the moment. You know, people are coming out and getting their third doses as quickly as possible. Our health workers, I'm making sure that any staff who are eligible for their third doses can get easy access. They get priority anyway as far as vaccinations, but that it's easily available to them to come and get vaccinated as soon as they are eligible.
New South Wales has this morning announced that people could face a fine if they don't register their vaccine result. Is that something we consider?
Look, I think the question for New South Wales is, how are they going to actually monitor that? How do you know someone's got a positive test in a home kit at home and haven't reported it? You know, are you going to start asking people in the household to start dobbing them in? I mean, I just don't know how they're going to monitor it. And is that the best use of resources right now?
And so can you explain the breakdown of that supplies, where they're coming from, where they're going to be distributed from, both in terms of guest days, in terms of
Commonwealth
as well as the
other two months? Sure. Yeah, and I think the figures I saw this morning is around 21,000 tests have been distributed to our testing clinics in the last 24 hours. Look, we're expecting just short of a million from the Commonwealth in the next week, but around 500,000 of those are point of care tests. Now, we're talking with our interstate colleagues about this as well. This is a concern, because these will not only not alleviate any of the problems with lines at testing clinics, but it'll actually add to the length of time that staff need to be inputting data and spending time with actually individuals coming forward for tests, because those people will need to wait around. They will then need to be told what their results are. All of that results will have to be entered into the system at the front end instead of at the back end that normally occurs. And that will take time away. So that would actually mean, if we want to keep those lines moving at the same rate they are now, which we know is still leading to delays and long waits, we'd have to put on extra staff. That makes no sense. These tests were supposed to alleviate pressures, not add pressures. I'll be talking with health ministers this afternoon about this in the Commonwealth.
Where are we at with that 500,000 batch of
We have around, we have over 400,000, I believe, currently now. Not all of them were from that one company that originally was going to deliver the 500,000, but we've been able to source almost 500,000 already. We've got more coming into the state this week and more are scheduled to come in. I can get that figure to you. As I say, I think yesterday I might have reported to you that there'd been around, I think, over 2,000 handed out, but I'll get that figure for you. So we're working that out at the moment. You know, they are given to us for frontline staff, but they were also supposed to be provided to all the states to help with the pressures on our public testing clinics. Now, I think I don't necessarily want to speak to for every state and territory, but I suspect every health minister right now is thinking, I might be better off using the point of care tests internally for the public health system as opposed to on the front line in the public testing lines, because it's just going to increase the burden, not help it. It's a challenge. I know a lot of people are ordering them online at the moment. I know a lot of the sites online all say out of stock. I know people, the moment they come on the shelves in our supermarkets and our pharmacies, they're going again. So is there ready supply out there that anyone who wants one can get one? No. No. And if the Commonwealth can do anything more to get more in the hands of Queenslanders, they need to do it, because businesses are suffering. You know, businesses, we would like more testing for those staff who have to go back to work. We would, I'll be absolutely clear, our preference is more frequent testing of those close contacts who have to go back to work, and we've seen the AHPPC guidance on that. But how do you do that when the tests are just not readily available? That's not correct. What the Premier said is that where you can work from home, while we go into our peak, we ask people to work from home. And the Premier has said, you are part of the vulnerable cohort. Not everybody. We're talking about those most vulnerable in the community. Those who have underlying health conditions that we know put them more at risk. Our elderly who might not have had their boosters. You know, we have said the most vulnerable might consider staying away from very crowded events and places. We have never said, and the Premier has not said, everyone should just stay home. We've said those most vulnerable should consider avoiding those heavily populated areas at the moment while we head into our peak. If you are following, we still want people to work from home where they can, because again, that reduces the risk of transmission in the workplace that then gets taken into the home. So that is a measure that we know when people, businesses can continue working if they can have their staff working from home. So that doesn't necessarily disrupt the business if they can still be working, but from a safer environment. So we know that's one measure that can work. The masks are another really important measure that we know can work. Our mandatory vaccination rules around staff and industries and consumers and customers, we know that can help. And so all of these things, social distancing, good hygiene, all of those things can help. We think these are sensible, responsible measures that we know can make a difference. And you only need to look at our hospitalisation and ICU rates compared to our overall population and the number of cases we are seeing at the moment. And we are seeing a manageable number. It's still going to put pressure on our systems, and we are still, you know, working to ensure we open up bed capacity. But we are comfortable with the numbers we're seeing in hospitals right now, because that is showing the rate of vaccination and the benefits vaccination have. And I echo what the Chief Health Officer just said. You know, if you are unvaccinated out there, the clear evidence now, based on hospitalisation rates, is you are 9 times more likely to end up in hospital than someone who is triple vaxxed. The evidence is clear. Go get vaccinated.
So if you are vaccinated, you're not considered vulnerable, and you know, you're doing the right thing, you do not have to limit
your society. No, just be sensible. You know, do the social distancing, wear your mask and wear it properly. Wear it everywhere we've asked you to wear it. And then if you find yourself in situations where even if you're outdoors, you know, there's large crowds, you may want to wear your mask as well. All these measures make a difference. We know they make a difference. And the Premier has said it is the most vulnerable in the community that are most at risk and that we want to protect. And we simply recommend that they may want to consider not staying at home and not moving, but to limit going into those areas that are heavily populated.
Yes, we are concerned about those vaccination rates, and we are Yes, we remain concerned about vaccination rates in some of the First Nations communities. Others are better, but some of them we are concerned about, and we are actively pursuing measures to increase the rate. So there are teams from Queensland Health in all these areas helping the local communities to improve their vaccination rates.
You said 9 times more likely to end up in hospital.
Yes. Yes, that's right. We haven't looked at those data in detail. We know that double vaccination is not as good as triple vaccination in terms of preventing hospitalisation, and particularly seeing a large proportion of the hospitalised are the more vulnerable. So it gets emphasised. I'm just trying to emphasise this message, particularly if you're over the age of 50 or 60, or vulnerable, you should get that third dose. In fact, anyone. Who is now entitled to that for third dose, which is 4 months after the second dose, should get it, because we know that it reduces your chances of being hospitalised. You're less likely to get sick. You get much higher antibody levels. So that's why I wanted to focus on that metric, and that's what we've been working on with the statisticians overnight, because you've been asking about this for a while. That is the key measure of the success of the vaccination. We know. If we didn't have a vaccination program as we've had in the last 12 months here in Queensland, the health system would clearly be overwhelmed. It would be overwhelmed. But we've got more than, we've had well over 100,000 documented cases, and it's likely to be much larger number of true cases of COVID-19 in the community. And yet, we're still seeing these small numbers of patients in our intensive care units, and that's because of vaccination. Yep.
You put that down to more people are just accepting it, not being tested, but are we actually seeing a slight reduction?
No. No. It's due to reduced testing. And this always happens. This is always what we expected with that epidemic, that you will reach testing capacity either because of the limits of the physical capacity of your systems, or also because people don't get tested. So that is quite expected. We always knew that would happen with the pandemic. What we look at now as we go forward is hospitalisation rates. And our data seems to suggest that hospitalisation rates, I've been saying a week, but it may be slightly less than that a week. So the hospitalisation will follow within about 5 days of infection. So it's a very good marker of where the pandemic is going in the general community, hospitalisation rates. We have several models that we're using. I don't want to talk about that at this stage. I can't recall. There are several models.
Look, I can't say too much because it's still with the triple C. It's certainly disappointing to be aware that this occurred. I think What I do want to say, though, is it shouldn't be seen as a reflection of the work that QIMR does. They do incredible work, important work, and this is one individual. And, you know, that you know, if this individual is found to have done wrong, we'll be held accountable for it. But I don't want to preempt what comes out of the Triple C. Oh, of course I am. But we know no business, private or public, you know, is immune to an individual doing wrong things. I know that QMIR have already put in place a range of changes so that something like this would be first hard to do and would be identified very quickly if it was to occur. But they're extremely disappointed, very disappointed that Yeah, so I'm, and I know I was asked about the aged care facility yesterday. What I've been able to find out is, that's a council-run aged care facility. I understand the Commonwealth working with them about possibly being able to relocate them to another private facility at the moment. I do want to say this, though. I am concerned, and again, I will be raising this with the Commonwealth, about the private aged care sector. They are under pressure like we are about staffing, and I'm just not sure what the plan is from the Commonwealth perspective to support these aged care facilities when it comes to, because we know these are our most vulnerable people, the risk of a severe spread of the virus through these elderly people is can have very dire consequences, and I am concerned about the lack of staff and the ratios and whether patients are going to be able to be managed properly going forward. So I'll be asking the Commonwealth what their plan is to support the aged care sector as we move into this peak. As I said yesterday, we're having those conversations this week, so we'll be able to talk about exactly what happens in the next few days. We're having those discussions, so let's have the meeting. Those discussions are going to be happening this week about that. I've stood next to the Premier numerous times where the Premier has specifically said, as has the Chief Health Officer, that we particularly are sending a message to those most vulnerable in the community that they may want to look at avoiding those areas that are heavily populated to avoid large crowds while we move into this peak. That's the government's message. It's not an inconsistent message. We are very clear that if people are following the measures, if people are wearing the masks, social distancing, good hygiene and everything else, and they're not in that vulnerable category, and of course they're eligible to go out to hotels and pubs and clubs if they're fully vaccinated, then we're not telling people to stay away from those places.
That's what the Premier actually said.
The Premier has continually talked about vulnerable people. Our message is not that everyone should stay home right now. Thanks. Yeah, so there's no decisions have been made to reduce public transport services at this stage. Like every other government service, we are working through different models and contingencies as the number of cases escalate and as staff end up needing to go offline because they are positive or they are close contact. So that those planning work continue to be revised all the time. I know Transport and Main Roads are talking with the stakeholders around these plans, what that might look like, what the triggers would be, but there's been no decisions at the moment to reduce those services. Thanks, everyone. Thank you.